grew up here in New York City, this time of the year brings a lot of memories back. The hydrants and smells and I don't know, all of it, you know? Yeah, it's a very distinct thing. Once point in the Bronx is inclined to be much hotter than other neighborhoods, primarily because we're surrounded by highways. 24-hour constant movement creates a lot of different pockets of heat in the neighborhood that you feel all the time. We have a lot of the more vulnerable populations, you know? Folks that just got here from other countries, seniors that are not making any income. They can't maybe afford things like the fans and the ACs or the bill that comes with it.
Triple digits, 103 the projected heat index in the city tomorrow.
Three deaths are being blamed on the extreme heat that started.
People in New York City, New Yorkers who are at the greatest risk are getting sick and also dying because of the heat. We wanted to better understand how heat-related illness and death differed across New York City. Are all New Yorkers being impacted the same way? And the answer is that they're not. There are great inequalities. Jamie Madrigano at Columbia University, who was affiliated with CCRUN and NOAA, and researchers here at the health department started to look at how the distribution of heat-related illness and death differs across the city.
In cities, we have something called an urban heat island. The hot air gets trapped into the environment. And because of that, we see people dying of heat waves every year. And areas of Upper Manhattan and the Bronx were particularly heat sensitive, vulnerable areas. I wanted to see the research that I did inform policy. NOAA provided support and resources to get the project off the ground. We worked collaboratively with the New York City Department of Health and the New York City Mayor's Office over about a two-year period, and it was published in 2015. The great thing about doing this study as part of CCRUN and working directly with stakeholders, such as the New York City Department of Health, is that they were able to take the results immediately, bring it up through their management, and direct it over to the New York City Mayor's Office so that it could be acted upon.
The heat vulnerability study was the basis for the Cool Neighborhoods NYC strategy.
The city will be providing over 500 cooling centers. That's in city facilities and working with community-based organizations. There's over 500 locations around the city.
Even though the city activates all of these cooling centers, individuals aren't going to them as much as we would want them to. We realized that it was really important to reach people within their homes, which was the impetus to create a program like Be a Buddy.
Door knocking is very important. Having those folks strategically in the neighborhood that, again, know the right people that are going to need support, that's huge.
Fresh Meadows Library right here, see? That's a cooling center.
The point is very excited about this opportunity to work with the Department of Health and the Office of the Mayor.
So we're going to review what we just talked about.
For us, that means opening up this process for the community to come in and create part of that vision. If you don't give people a voice, they're not going to be an agent of change during these times.
We're really trying to think about how to empower the neighborhoods and give them the resources so that they can get to a place that's cool and stay safe.
If we have the tools, if we have the space to do this work, we can be our own citizen scientists, we can be our own first responders, and that's very, very key.
What it feels like to stand there with a condolence on your tongue with gunshots or firecrackers on the 4th of July?
Heat waves are the biggest killer of all weather events in the U.S. I knew that by working with CCRUN, the New York City Department of Health, and other stakeholders that are involved with CCRUN, my research would be used.
What we hope is that people can use this research to better understand heat health and also take action in their own communities.
It's really important that all New Yorkers know how to stay safe and to know what are those protective measures that you can take and to really think about checking in on those that might really need it.
Whatever we do now has an impact 20, 50 years down the line. What do we want to see in 2020, 2025, 2035? We're laying the groundwork for that now.